Okay, so can I start? Okay, so welcome to my presentation, which is about acrylamide and furane, which are two of the major contaminants found in coffee. And my presentation is under the title, How to Replace One Evil by Another. And to say it before, the problem is that if you avoid one of the contaminants, the other one is going up and the other way around. Here's a short summary about roasting contaminants in coffee. Basically, all these nasty compounds are not in your green bean, but they are formed during the roasting process. And probably all of you know acrylamide, which is also known from fried food, French fries and such products, or bread, bakery products. Whenever something like sugar is heated, acrylamide is formed. And the problem is that it's probably carcinogenic to humans. The second compound is furane, which is possibly carcinogenic to humans, as well as furfural alcohol. And the last compound is hydroxymethyl furfural, which is not genotoxic, it's not carcinogenic, but still it's hepatotoxic, so also not good for your health. Interestingly, despite that coffee includes all these nasty compounds, there is no evidence currently that coffee itself is carcinogenic. But still, as producer of coffee, you're supposed by law to avoid or reduce all of these compounds as far as it's technologically possible. So first, acrylamide, a bit more detail. It was discovered that it is found in food in Sweden in 2002. It's formed, as I told before, during processing of foods in industry, but also at home. So if you bake something or fry something at home, acrylamide is also formed. And the main influences are the presence of reducing sugars and the amino acid asparagine. And sugars as well as amino acids are also found in your green coffee bean, and therefore acrylamide is also formed during the roasting process. So here's a bit of detail about the formation process of acrylamide, which is here in the middle. So there are several pathways for acrylamide formation, so it's not a univariate process, but there are several possibilities, or all of those pathways may form acrylamide together. So the major pathway probably is shown on the left, upper left panel. It's, as I told before, asparagine, which is an amino acid and reducing sugars. Probably over this intermediate compound form acrylamide, but there are also other pathways from fats, fatty acids, and some other pathways which are not so interesting in coffee. For coffee, this pathway appears to be the major pathway of acrylamide formation. So what are the influences of formation in coffee? This is the coffee variety is important. Then the defective coffee beans. Basically the better your coffee, the less acrylamide. Then the highest influence is of course the roasting, as I will show later. And then we have other influences like storage time and conditions, and at the last thing, the coffee beverage preparation, the ratio, of course, is important for what amount you at the end have in your cup if you drink the coffee. But roasting from all of these factors has the highest influence. So here's a study who did research the degree of roasting and the acrylamide formation. So basically they used different steps of times until very, very black beans. And the longer you roast, of course 60 minutes is absurd, but this is an experimental approach. You see that all you have known probably before is inverse for coffee. Because for coffee, the longer you roast and the blacker it gets, the less acrylamide you have. So if you burn it to coal, charcoal, you almost have none acrylamide left. But if you make your fancy, very, very light roast, you are at the risk to have very, very high levels of acrylamide. So all you know from other foods, for example, for French fries, the darker the fries get, the more acrylamide you have. The same is for bread. The darker the crust of your bread is, the more acrylamide you have. But for coffee, it's different. The darker the coffee, the less acrylamide. And this finding was replicated by many, many other studies, which all found that light roasted coffee has higher levels than medium or dark roasted coffee. And here's another figure basically showing the distributions for acrylamide contents in very, very large samples. This is a Nestle study actually showing that the light roasted beans have this acrylamide profile between 500 and 1,000 microgram per kilogram, and the dark roasted distribution is here, which is from 200 to 600 micrograms per kilogram. So now I want to show you some own investigations which we have done in collaboration with Dr. Schwarz here from Coffee Consulate, who made the roasting experiments here. And we then have analyzed the acrylamide content. Actually, this is done in our central laboratory for acrylamide analysis in Stuttgart, while the central coffee laboratory which I'm heading is in Karlsruhe, so we are collaborating also with different institutes. And what you see here is we have selected six different roast profiles, and if you're a roaster, you probably know these terms. Basically, what we did, we went from different coffee roastings with fast and slow drying, the same for espresso roasts, but we also selected a Scandinavian coffee profile, which is the lightest profile, as well as a very, very dark profile. We learned this morning about the Italian espresso roasts, and we selected a Napolitan profile, which is a very, very black, dark roasted espresso profile. And for the science nerds within you here, the roasting curves and all the roast data, basically what you see here is the end temperature which we reached, and the temperature curve here. Here are the results of our investigations of acrylamide, but also of the other contaminants I mentioned before for those six different roast profiles. And we actually have done this for an Arabica and a Canephora roast, but basically the trend was the same. So I here only show one result. Interestingly, the benchmark level for acrylamide is 400 micrograms per kilogram. So coffee which is sold in Europe, this is a European Union level, should be below 400. And if you see that from all those profiles, only the Scandinavians, a very, very light roast, exceeded this benchmark level by 70 micrograms per kilogram. So we had 470 acrylamide in this roast. And the lowest value was very black Neapolitan espresso was only 130 micrograms per kilogram of acrylamide. So we are far from the benchmark level with this roast, but also with the normal coffee and normal standard espresso roast, we are much below this benchmark level. So if you are doing a normal roast, probably you are not in danger to exceed the benchmark level. Only if you do this very, very fancy light roast, you really should do a control of acrylamide in your sample. But now the problem is the other contaminant furan, which is similarly carcinogenic like acrylamide. So furan behaves actually the other way around. So if we have this black Neapolitan espresso, we have the highest level of furan in the sample, and this is now milligrams, not micrograms, so this is much higher than acrylamide in concentration. And if you look at the light roast, their furan was not detectable. It was below the limit of quantitation of our method. And the coffee and the espresso roast are again in the middle between those extremes. So we also have a correlation, a negative correlation between some of these contaminants. Here, for example, I have made a picture of acrylamide, which is on the x-axis to furfural alcohol. And the higher the acrylamide levels are, the lower are the levels of furfural alcohol, which is yet another of those heat-induced contaminants. So are there several different formation and degradation processes during coffee roasting. So what options for mitigation of this contaminant have you? Basically, there are some probably not so practical options like using enzymes to degradate the precursor compounds which form acrylamide, or you can do blends with higher amounts of Arabica because less acrylamide is formed from Arabica than from Carnifora. You can select coffee plants with lower amounts of asparagine, but this is probably also not very practical. Longer storage might lead to reduced concentrations, but perhaps the largest influence, as I showed, has the roasting conditions. But still, then there is the danger that of the unintended effect that other contaminants are increased, and this is also not considered by the European regulation regarding acrylamide, which is looking solely at acrylamide but not at the other contaminants in coffee. So this is the regulation actually it's from 2017 on the mitigation measures and benchmark levels for the reduction of the presence of acrylamide in food, which includes coffee, and this is, as told before, only focused on acrylamide but not on the other contaminants. What does this regulation demand from you as food business operator? You should do a consideration of your coffee blend regarding a risk assessment to intending to reduce higher acrylamide levels, for example, in looking at the blend between Carnifera and Arabica. You should look at your pure processing on the critical roast conditions, which I shortly presented to you, and you should do this in a fashion like inside of your good manufacturing practice concept. Then you should consider the use of asparaginase treatment, but basically this is probably not possible, apart perhaps from very, very large producers. And then we have the benchmark level for acrylamide, 400 micrograms. And as I told before, if you have normal roast profiles, except those very, very light profiles, probably there is no risk, or the risk is very low that the benchmark level is exceeded. So in practice of our control of the German market, at least we very, very seldom see exceedances of the benchmark level. So let me conclude that the most important point I want to transport here is that coffee shows an inverse behavior compared to other foods, so that the darker the roast, the less acrylamide. This is really important because often you read on internet presentations of many roasteries, you read exactly the difference. They want to make you believe that their fancy roast, light roast, is less acrylamide, but exactly the opposite is actually happening. Then very, very critical are those very light roasts, Scandinavian roasts, for example. And otherwise, I would say that with standard medium or espresso roasts, the benchmark level cannot be reached with normal coffee roasting or what we see on the commercial market. What I would make is to try to do disproportionate mitigation measures which might lead to higher levels of other contaminants. So you do not need to have nil acrylamide or zero acrylamide. This is not necessary if the benchmark level is 400, but if you do that, you are at the risk of having much, much higher levels of the other contaminants, such as furan. And so a holistic risk assessment would be preferable in the future that is not based on univariate parameters, but looks at many of those heat-formed contaminants in total and makes a measure on all of these contaminants. So thank you for your attention. And at the end, I also want to thank my colleagues from Stuttgart for the acrylamide analysis. So thank you. Yes, there's a question.
You know, I'm a coffee rookie, but which role does the geometry and thickness of the beans play, and also the conductivity? Does these factors play a role? Because you mentioned when the bread is burning on the outside and you have a lot of these.
Yeah, probably there's an influence, but we are currently actually conducting a master thesis into these questions of the influences of the different roasting parameters, also with the infrared roaster, which can be looked at downstairs, which is a completely other principle of heat transfer into the bean. And we are currently investigating if this might have an influence or not. But currently what I can say from what we currently know is that basically the only influencing factor is the amount of energy you bring into the bean, and it does not depend the fashion of which, how you bring it into the bean. So we tried different profiles, faster profiles or longer profiles, but if they have basically the same ending temperature or the bean, the roast degree is the same at the end, it will have more or less the same amount of acrylamide despite the way or the profile in which you get to this level.
Because in the food of cooking, some are really burning their food and then just take away the outer shell, right? Which is usually the critical part.
Probably there's also a gradient of acrylamide if you would make slices of the beans, and probably on the outside, which is in larger contact with the heat, it's probably less than in the inside, which is slightly protected. But
because you analyze the
ground
powder.
But I don't know if anyone has actually done such kinds of analysis so far.
Does it make sense to bring heat to friction and turbulences during the roasting more? I mean, I just know that it's very slow turbulences during heating or roasting.
I can't say apart from that it just depends on the amount of energy that gets into the bean and the way you get this energy into the bean is more or less irrelevant. This is the current knowledge.
If I may add, if you would increase the speed, so the way the drum runs, for instance, you would change the energy transmission from conduction to more convection, which would definitely lead into a less desirable flavor profile. Because more you have conduction, more you have radiation, you have a much better body, and you have a much more balanced flavor profile in total. And this is why the industry is usually using a lot of convection or conventional roasters, because it is more easy to work fast with big amounts of coffee, but it's always lacking body and it's always lacking balance, which is quite interesting. It's like when you have potatoes in a frying pan and you leave them a certain while before you turn. If you consistently turn, you end up with having a lot of broken, not really nice, crispy fried potatoes, but a lot of mesh that absorbed a lot of fat. And that's a little bit the effect if you have too much of turbulence. So, but I think the ideas are interesting, and while you were asking, I was asking myself, did we ever try and measure anything on Liberica? I think we forgot that so far.
Yeah.
Because since it has a complete other protein content, there might be another effect also what it could bring, like also when you concluded that there is an influence by the genetics of the plant,
yeah.
Of course, maybe the different species would be different.
Probably there is also an influence of the subgroups of inside Arabica and Carnifora, depending on the sugar content alone, which is quite different on the processing, yes.
If it's fully washed or if it's natural or not natural. So that proves that the Neapolitanians can eat more pizza because they have the dark roasted coffee, so it balances out the acrylamide.
And they drink only very, very small amounts of it. Yeah.
But it could be interesting maybe one day to get some samples from different Italian roasters and analyze how the amount of acrylamide actually is. Because I would believe intuitively those roasters do it the same way and therefore they should have rather low acrylamide values. While the world would believe that the good is the fast, is the very light roast, like, as we always believe.
Yeah.
And now we can see it's clearly wrong. The opposite is. Right. Okay, any more questions?
One question. The acrylamide, you measure in the powder or in the liquid?
No, in the powder.
And so it would be interesting during the preparation of the coffee,
yes.
When you put some water on it, how much you have in the cup?
100%. It's very, very well water soluble. So it just depends on your technique you're using for coffee preparation, how much powder, how much water, and then you can basically just calculate the amount that's getting inside the cup.
Okay. It's also the same with the other, with Furan?
Yes, yes.
It's the same.
Furan, you have the luck, so to say, that it's very, very volatile, So if you make a filter coffee and leave your can standing, like, which is a normal office practice for 3 hours, then the coffee tastes very, very bad, but the furan has evaporated in the meantime.
Otherwise, Dr. Lachermeyer will leave the house. So for everyone that is online, you can still charter a plane, come here. There's an airport in Mannheim. It's your chance.
Yeah.
Well, then, I think we have the last presentation for today, following up. And I just switch right over.